Thank you very much, Chairman Corker and Ranking Member Cardin and all the members of this committee. It's I really appreciate the opportunity to provide an update on how we're doing on implementation of the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, or the JCPOA. My name is Ambassador Steve Mull. I have served as a career member of the Foreign Service for almost 34 years. And shortly after the JCPOA was concluded in July, Secretary Kerry asked me to return to Washington from my last post as ambassador to Poland to serve as the lead coordinator for implementing the deal. In this job, I'm leading a terrific team of colleagues in the State Department, as well as at the Departments of Energy, Treasury, Commerce, and other parts of our government to make sure that the JCPOA is fully implemented to enhance not only the security of our country, but also of our friends and allies around the world. I'm really pleased that two of my colleagues, Department of Energy Undersecretary for Nuclear Security and Administrator of the National Nuclear Security Administration, General Frank Klotz, and Assistant Secretary Tom Countryman, Assistant Secretary for National Security and Nonproliferation, are here with me today. And I'm especially honored to meet with this committee, which has been such a valuable partner in shaping our Iran policy over many decades, with bipartisan support for our common strategic objective, as you mentioned, Senator Corker, of preventing a nuclear-armed Iran. As you mentioned, our government has numerous and serious concerns about Iran's policy in the region, which are unrelated to the nuclear deal. We continue to raise concerns about detained Americans that you mentioned, about Iran's support for terrorism, its hostility to Israel, or its human rights abuses, which are rampant. But my job is solely focused on the critical task of making sure the JCPOA achieves its one crucial objective: preventing Iran from developing a nuclear weapons capability. When fully implemented, the JCPOA will dramatically scale back Iran's nuclear program and provide unprecedented monitoring and verification tools to ensure that it is exclusively peaceful as it moves forward. We are making steady progress towards this objective. October 18th marked adoption day under the JCPOA when the deal formally came into effect. On this day, all the participants began making the necessary arrangements for the implementation of their JCPOA commitments. That included Iran's informing the International Atomic Energy Agency, the IAEA, that it would provisionally apply the additional protocol and fully implement Modified Code 3.1, which provides for early declaration of nuclear facilities and granting unprecedented access to Iran's entire nuclear program from cradle to grave. These are two important mechanisms which will ensure the international community has much greater insight into Iran's nuclear program than it's ever had before. The P5+1 and Iran have also issued an official document outlining the plan for redesigning the Iraq Heavy Water Research Reactor so that it will no longer be able to produce weapons-grade plutonium. And the United States and the European Union have taken actions to lift nuclear-related sanctions upon reaching, and only upon reaching, implementation day, when all of these commitments will be met. Implementation day is the next major milestone in the JCPOA, and it will occur only after the IAEA verifies that Iran has completed all of the nuclear steps that we specified in the agreement. These are the technical steps that will quadruple Iran's breakout time to at least a year from the current estimate of less than 90 days. At that time, Iran will receive relief from the U.S., the EU, and UN nuclear-related sanctions. The timing for reaching implementation day is primarily within Iran's control. However, I reiterate that Iran will receive no sanctions relief under the JCPOA until it has verifiably met all of its nuclear commitments. Since adoption day, Iran has been making tangible progress to reach those commitments. For example, Iran has begun dismantling its uranium enrichment infrastructure by removing so far more than 5,000 centrifuges and transferring them for storage under continuous IAEA surveillance. It has begun to move quickly now to remove the remaining 8,000 in the coming days. Iran is also reducing its stockpile of various forms of enriched uranium to no more than 300 kilograms of up to 3.67% enriched material. It will accomplish this primarily by shipping a significant amount of such material outside of Iran, while diluting the remaining excess to the level of natural uranium or below. Commercial contracts are in place for Iran to ship its enriched uranium stockpiles to Russia. We expect that this material, about 25,000 pounds of enriched up to 20% low enriched uranium, will leave Iran in the coming weeks. This step alone will significantly lengthen Iran's breakout time. As I briefed the committee before, Iran must also remove and render inoperable the existing calandria, or core, of the Arak reactor by filling it with concrete before implementation day can occur. These actions will effectively cut off Iran's ability to produce weapons-grade plutonium. Iran and the P5+1 are also continuing work to advance the redesign and reconstruction of the reactor so that it can no longer produce that weapons-grade plutonium. The P5+1 have set up a working group to facilitate this project, which will begin to meet soon after the new year. Regarding the possible military dimension of Iran's past nuclear program, an issue on which all of us have been very focused, on October 15th, the IAEA announced that Iran had fulfilled its commitment under the so-called Roadmap for Clarification of Past and Present Outstanding Issues, as agreed to with the IAEA. Subsequently, on December 2nd, the IAEA Director General released the final assessment on past and present outstanding issues regarding Iran's nuclear program. The report confirmed and corroborated what we and the international community have long known, that Iran had a structured nuclear weapons program up until 2003, but there are no indications that that program is continuing today. This candid assessment gives us further confidence that the IAEA will perform its duties related to the JCPOA vigorously and honestly. And just this week, on December 15th, the IAEA Board of Governors, in a special session, adopted a consensus resolution addressing that report. This resolution, submitted by the P5+1, turns the board's focus from confirming what we already knew about Iran's past activity towards fully implementing the JCPOA. This resolution gives the IAEA much better tools for deterring and detecting weapons-related activities going into the future. We also continue to work closely with the IAEA as it makes preparations to implement the JCPOA's unprecedented monitoring and verification provisions of Iran's entire nuclear program. The IAEA will have continuous monitoring of all of Iran's key declared nuclear facilities. This includes uranium mills as well as centrifuge production facilities, a first for the IAEA. These measures specific to the JCPOA will give us increased confidence Iran is not diverting material or equipment to a covert program. We've always said that this deal isn't based on trust, but rather on intense verification of Iran's program. That's why we're working so closely with the IAEA to make sure it has everything it needs to do this crucial job. Meanwhile, we continue to engage with our international partners and other matters pertaining to implementation of the JCPOA and reaching implementation day. U.S. experts continue to meet with our P5+1 partners and others, including the EU and Iran, on setting up the procurement channel. That's the mechanism by which we will, together with the UN Security Council, review and approve or disapprove transfers of nuclear supplier group-controlled items and technology to Iran's nuclear and non-nuclear civilian industry, as well as other items that we think are inconsistent with the program. And on sanctions, we continue to work within the U.S. government, as well as with the EU and others, to make the necessary arrangements to lift the nuclear-related sanctions once the IAEA confirms Iran has completed its commitments and we reach implementation day. Full implementation of this deal is in our interest, in our partners' interests as well. It will place Iran's nuclear program under an unprecedented verification and monitoring regime, and when fully implemented, it'll give us and the international community the tools necessary to ensure that Iran's nuclear program is exclusively peaceful. It will make us, Israel, our Gulf partners, and the whole world safer. The continuing, I'm at your disposal 24/7, every day of the week, as we go forward in this deal. Senators, I look forward to this being the first of many engagements with you. We really value your partnership and guidance as we go forward towards our common objective. I look forward to taking your questions.